Usually, I'm one to say that I'm not a big fan of horror movies on principle. That's not to say that there aren't some horror movies that I like, but on the whole, I'm not a person who gets much catharsis out of feeling scared, and that's assuming that the movie is actually effectively scary in the first place. Plenty of horror movies aren't, and unscary horror movies are the biggest waste of time ever, in my opinion, next to unfunny comedies. Of course, then there's the whole conversation of movies that get billed or advertised by the studio as horror, but aren't really, and whether or not they should be held to a different scale, but that's besides the point, because The Conjuring is not only absolutely a horror movie, but a bloody scary one. The setup is simple. The Perrins are a loving family of five girls and their parents who are a bit strapped for cash after moving into a new old house. Things seem normal, but really it's haunted, you know the drill. As we see this, we're also introduced to the Warrens, a paranormally inclined couple who might be just what they need to put an end to the increasingly horrific dealings occurring around the house. The first and most important thing that I think The Conjuring does right is something that a lot of horror movies seem to neglect, which is making me invested in the cast. I'm made to sympathize with this family because even though the first stretch of their haunting manifests mainly as just a bunch of really bad stuff going on around the house, they all handle it maturely and take it in stride. A lesser movie with this same setup could have had them all be really whiny or snippy with each other over their problems, under the assumption that that's the more human and relatable reaction. Even the kids are mostly empathetic with each other, and that goes a long way toward me actually feeling dread when it looks like one of them might be in danger. This nuanced approach to characterization also applies to the Warrens. They treat their work and their faith seriously, but also readily proclaim the existence of more rational explanations where they can be found. They're not obsessive wackos, but instead multifaceted, compelling protagonists. Being based on real events, I feel like the movie goes out of its way to treat all of its subjects with respect. The Perrins, the Warrens, even their young assistant Drew are all characters I just like to see. Even the token skeptic in the form of residing police officer Brad isn't the belligerently arbitrary skeptic he could have been. When all parties meet up and get to work after the first act, their chemistry is instant and palpable. Surprise, making me like characters makes me feel scared for their safety when bad things happen. Honestly though, I was so utterly invested in these people, I came close to tearing up at the end. Having likable, rational people being the ones you place into the horrifying situations is something a lot of the genre could stand to learn, but it's also not the only thing this film does right. There's a real sense of escalation to the threat, unlike some horror movies that either start big and stay big, or, more commonly, drag their feet harder than Ren from adult party cartoon without actually building the things. The fact that there's not just one, but a plethora of ghosts haunting the Perrins was something I didn't see coming and really upped the tension. Like I said earlier, the trouble starts off low-key, though still off-putting, and the Perrins' attempts to persevere as events keep pushing them to the breaking point makes me feel increasingly more tense. It doesn't have an overblown, elongated climax that overstays its welcome either. All the scenes of haunting are spaced out with character interactions and backstory, so each one feels like an event. An event that keeps me really excited, even though, comparatively to other more blown-out movies, there's not all that much that's actually happening. Maybe it's just that the movie manages to consistently feel grounded in a sense of reality, where even comparatively little things like that would feel pants-wettingly awful if they were to actually happen. To touch on the more technical aspects of the film, although the movie's universe isn't very stylized, its cinematography certainly is. The shaky cam was a choice that I was initially taken out by before I realized that it mainly exists to create a complement to the instability the characters are feeling when spiritual activity is actively in progress. For the most part, it's only when a haunting is happening or when we're looking at one of the film's multiple POV shots that a shaky cam is being used. The few instances outside of that where it does happen do feel a bit incongruous, though, at least in contrast with the steady, deliberate style of the rest of the film. A lot of the film is done with a very graceful camera, so it takes me a bit to clue in if what I think is happening is what's really going on. Outside of the shaky cam, there are still a lot of choices that shoot for stylistic rather than naturalistic, such as the Warren's assistant Andrew setting things up around the house in a way that crosses multiple rooms as if it were one shot. Shots that are upside down, shots that follow radical shifts in the character's eyeline, etc. There are even some shots that I think I'm meant to interpret as being from the POV of the ghosts around the house, and that's a really creative choice. Not to mention very subtle, as it's easy to interpret that as being something else. All in all, The Conjuring as a movie managed to really win me over after I went in not expecting much. But how does the sequel fare? Well, right off the bat, the same sense of style is still there, with a really impressive opening sequence and several neato flourishes early on in the film. There's also a greater number of moments where the sound direction caught my attention in a good way. This time around, the Warrens are called to a case that creates quite a nice contrast with that of the Perrins. As opposed to a quintessential middle American nuclear clan, the clientele this time around is a dysfunctional English single-parent household. Of course, it is still the Warren, so it's still a haunted house. And beyond that sense of foiling, there's not really too much different about this setup. Honestly, there might be a bit too many similarities. I couldn't help but find it a bit lazy that the central emotional dilemma seemed to be just switching Ed and Lorraine's places from that of the last film. Instead of Ed struggling to go through the exorcism because he fears for Lorraine's safety, it's the other way around. Unlike the first film, though, there's no real payoff to that angle. Lorraine's vision of Ed's death is tied into the first film, but unlike Ed's fears in the first Conjuring, it doesn't really factor into the story or any of Lorraine's decisions in any significant way after it's brought up. By the end of the film, it might as well not have been mentioned. If anything drops this sequel a couple of rungs below the first one, it's that. Although I will admit there are a couple of other story decisions that I like. I like exploring the idea of a spirit that doesn't know it's a spirit and still sees itself as a man, and the rightful owner of his property. Perhaps there could have been a little bit more done with that, but by the end of the film it does seem like an idea that they were paying attention to at the very least. Although to swing back around to my problems with the story, I think that there's way less of a focus given to the haunted family as a unit this time around. And that might be the reason I feel a touch less invested. Both films have large sets of kids to juggle, but I came out of the first film feeling like I had more of a sense of each of the parent children's separate identities. Or if not that, at least a feeling that each one had a significant presence. Contrast to The Conjuring 2, where there are long stretches of the film where I forget that some of the kids are even there. Maybe the movie is just trying not to come off like a copy and paste of the first film by handling its ensemble differently. And given that we're once again dealing with real-life events, I can't fault them for trying to work around what are very clearly two similar setups. Unfortunately, I just feel like a lot of the storytelling decisions in The Conjuring 2 don't hold up when compared to the first one. For instance, we fall into that trope that I commended the last film for avoiding by giving a belligerently smug, skeptic character who only serves to put a damper on the conflict and just be a smug, unlikable ponce. At the point of the movie where they're relevant, the audience knows for a fact that the haunting is genuine and has known for well over an hour. Wasting even just 5 minutes on a "has Janet really been doing it all herself" plot point felt utterly unnecessary. I missed the presence of characters like Brad and Drew, and honestly, at the expense of being too dismissive and short-handed with what is still a pretty interesting movie with a lot of ideas that I could go into, The Conjuring 2 just feels like the lesser version of The Conjuring 1. If I'm not making that comparison, it's still a perfectly effective and well-made horror movie, but it's the one of the two that I'm least likely to go back to. I apologize to no one and everyone in particular for how short this video is going to come out. I've been trying to keep up with the scripted content, but let's just say that the past couple of weeks have been increasingly busy on my end. With that said, I do have a new editor in the form of my friend Malik, who's not only been a part of my live streams recently, but who will also be editing the rest of my content for the foreseeable future, including my very next review, which is going to be a look at the Netflix Castlevania series. After that, you can expect that I'll inevitably get back to some Doctor Who stuff, and if I have the time, I'll attempt to branch out even further. Requested reviews like this one are always open for acceptance, although, of course, you have to be patient, seeing as they're going to take a while. With that said, take to the comments if you have a request, or maybe even just some thoughts on the Conjuring movies. I hope you enjoyed, despite this review being a little bit of a rushed job, and that you stick around on the channel for what I hope is some better content. Here's hoping that you found enough to like about this video as is, and if that's the case, that you click the like button and stick around on this channel for any future content.